Welcome home and congratulations on your new hip. In the months to come, your quality of life will greatly improve. However, there's still plenty of work to do in order for you to get the most out of your new hip. We know how traumatic any surgery can be, but the reward you'll receive for being diligent about your own recovery will be so worthwhile. We want you to return to an active lifestyle as quickly as possible. And to assist you on your road to recovery, we've provided this program, which contains tips for safety around the home, a discussion about medications, and a guide for basic wound care. We've also provided you with a video exercise program. Michael will guide you through a series of important exercises to assure optimal recovery. It's very important that you take the time to exercise at least 3 or 4 times a day. Please feel free to share this video with your coach or physical therapist.
Some people recover better than others because they stick with their exercise program for 3, 4, 5, or 6 months after their surgery. And you want to be doing these exercises 3 or 4 times a day to optimize your strength and your range of motion and get you back to your normal day, your normal activities of daily living, and the things you love to do.
Let's begin with a review of some of the things you learned during your hospital stay. It's critical that you understand and follow all of the precautions you were given while in the hospital regarding your new hip. For the next 6 to 8 weeks, you need to follow total hip precautions to the letter. Your surgeon will let you know when you can relax on these precautions. For example, don't cross your legs. This lifelong habit can lead to hip dislocation during the early recovery period. Also, when getting up from a chair or toilet, it's vital that you don't bend at the waist more than 70 degrees. Use your walker at all times until you're told otherwise. The first trick to using a walker is take your time. Don't rush anything right now. Don't use your walker for support until your weight is positioned directly above the walker. Remember to push yourself up from the arms of a chair or the bed rather than trying to pull yourself up using the walker. And walk into the walker. Don't let it get too far ahead of you. Take your time. Use good posture. Keep your head high and your toes pointing straight ahead. When you're out and about, wear shoes with good support and proper soles. Your walker will need lots of room in order to turn around, so make sure you have plenty of space. Up with the good, down with the bad. This is one of the best ways to remember how to safely navigate the stairs. Up with the good leg, down with the surgical leg. When going up the stairs, your stronger or non-surgical leg leads the way. And when coming down the stairs, the surgical leg leads. Let's take a moment to review your home environment. On the best of days, your home presents a number of potential safety concerns. As you recover from your surgery, it's critical that you provide yourself with the safest home environment possible. Here are some general tips for improving safety around your home. Remove scatter and area rugs. Keep power cords and decorative items off the floor and out of your pathway. You may also need to temporarily rearrange furniture to clear walkways. Before going to bed at night, make sure your walker is at your bedside and there's a clear pathway to the bathroom. If you have a pet, be sure and keep her a safe distance away, especially if she's used to being in your sleeping area, because your best friend may unwittingly become an unfortunate tripping hazard. Remember, too, that your pet may not be accustomed to you using a walker, so make decisions accordingly. If you have any doubts about doing any task, please get help and always pace yourself. Organize the items you frequently use in your kitchen and keep them in easy reach. Make sure the floor is free of spills and, for the time being, remove those slippery foot-catching throw rugs. When getting up in the morning, take your time. Stretch your arms and legs. Sit up on the side of the bed for a few minutes and get your balance. When sitting, choose a high, firm chair with armrests. Those armrests make it a lot easier to get out of the chair later on. Be very careful of wet floors and consider using a non-skid mat both inside and outside of your tub or shower. We all know the hazards of a slippery shower or bath stall. If you've been advised to use a raised toilet seat, this device will definitely help you rise up easier. Now, here are some suggestions for bathing during the early postoperative period. We strongly suggest you continue with sponge baths only until the staples are removed. Do not soak in a hot tub or take a tub bath or shower until your incision is completely healed or until you have approval from your physician. If your incision gets wet, don't rub it dry. Instead, gently pat the area with a clean, dry towel. It's likely that you may have been sent home with a medication called a blood thinner. Blood thinners help reduce the risk of blood clots by increasing the time it takes for your blood to clot. The length of time you'll be taking this medication depends on your doctor's prescription. While you're taking a blood thinner, it's important that you don't take any aspirin or aspirin-containing products unless your doctor has specifically instructed otherwise. The addition of these products can increase the potency of most blood thinners. Other over-the-counter anti-inflammatory medications, such as ibuprofen, Motrin, Aleve, and Advil, for example, may also increase the action of blood thinners. Even vitamin E can increase a blood thinner's potency. If you have any doubts about which medications you may take besides your prescriptions, contact your doctor. Some blood thinners require blood samples during your treatment to monitor their effectiveness. Others don't. Blood thinners may be prescribed for a week or longer. Your surgeon will decide what's best for you. It's very important that you read and clearly understand the specific information provided by the hospital and the pharmacy for the medication you're taking. Remember to check with your doctor, pharmacist, or healthcare professional before taking any over-the-counter medicines or before beginning any new medications. They'll monitor your medications and let you know what's right for you. Now let's talk about pain medications. Take your pain medication as prescribed by your doctor. They work best if you take them regularly. You may want to take your medication 30 to 60 minutes before your exercise session, which will help you achieve your exercise goals more comfortably and speed you on the road to recovery. Physical inactivity and pain medications have a tendency to cause constipation. In order to help prevent constipation, please remember to eat fresh fruits and vegetables and drink plenty of fluids. Your incision may be closed with staples or Steri-strips. Staples are typically removed 10 to 14 days or up to 3 weeks after surgery, as determined by your surgeon. The Steri-strips will loosen and fall off gradually on their own over the next several weeks. It's very important to observe changes in the appearance of your incision. Inspect your wound daily. You may need to use a mirror or have someone inspect your incision for you to maintain your hip precautions. The surgical site can be warm, swollen, reddened, or even bruised. These are all expected signs of healing. It's important to notice trends or changes in the appearance of your incision. In a normal wound, there may be some very slight drainage, which will subside. However, if drainage begins to occur again, it warrants attention. Also, increasing redness, streaking, or increasing pain are all conditions that need to be brought to your physician's attention. To reduce the risk of infection, there are a couple of things you can do. First of all, wash your hands frequently. At a minimum, wash your hands with soap after using the bathroom, before and after food contact, after blowing your nose or coughing, and after contact with pets. Secondly, you will minimize the risk of infection by not applying any cream, ointments, or lotions to your incision unless directed by your physician. This includes antibiotic ointments, vitamin E creams, and moisturizers. Hip replacement patients often experience a slight fever for the first few days after surgery. However, if a fever persists, say anything over 100.5 degrees, you should report this to your doctor. Another area of concern now that you've returned home is swelling of the surgical leg. Patients typically become more active at home than they were in the hospital. After exercise or long periods where your leg is in the dependent position, which is lower than the heart, you may experience swelling. This swelling may continue up to 3 months after surgery. To relieve swelling, it's important that you elevate your leg above your heart several times a day. The next few weeks are going to require a lot of commitment on your part. Be deliberate and take your time getting around. Use your medications as prescribed. Don't be shy about asking for help or communicating with your doctor as needed. And finally, make sure you exercise regularly as outlined in this program. By following these instructions, you'll be well on your way to new mobility.
The first exercise you're going to do is probably the easiest exercise you'll do for your knee or your hip replacement surgery, but it's also the most important, and it's just an ankle pump exercise. You're going to bring your feet out in front of you, and you're going to flex your feet up and down as far as you can. Bring your toes all the way up and all the way down. You need to do this about 3,000 times a day. I know it seems like a lot, but the average person walks about 3,000 steps a day, so this is going to mimic your normal walking activity and get you back to life. You can do it anytime during the day. You can just be sitting around the house, watching TV, get those ankles moving, really help that blood flow in your calves. That's crucial so that you don't get a blood clot. So if you remember to do nothing else, remember to move your feet constantly. Really get those feet pumping up and down. And you'll do around 30 or 40 at a time, and then your legs will start to fatigue a little bit. So you might have to take a little break and then come back to it. Okay, we're going to do some quad sets now. We're going to have your heel out on the ground with your toes up. You're going to tighten your thigh muscle and push down for about a count of 10. 2, 3, 4, 5. Good, keep going. And you're going to do 10 repetitions of this exercise. And push down. And this is real important for getting your thigh muscle, your quad muscle, back in shape. And it also promotes getting your knee straight again, which is very important for joint mechanics of a knee. 1, you're really getting that knee straight. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Relax and push down. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Relax.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
Now we're going to do some hamstring sets. You're going to bring your heel out on the ground again with a slight bend in your knee, and you're just going to dig your heel gently into the ground, trying to pull it towards you for a count of 5, and you're tightening up the muscles in the back of your leg, right? And then relax and let your toes relax. Good. And then pull your toes up and dig the heel again. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Good. Relax and bend and pull. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Good, relax. This should just be a gentle pull. Keep going. Nice and easy for 5 seconds. You're just working the muscles in the back of your leg. People tend to cramp up back there, so that's why you only hold this one for 5 seconds. If you hold it for 10, you might get a Charlie horse or a cramp in your hamstrings. Good, and relax.
bend and pull. Well, this also gets the muscle firing in the back of your leg, which is important because you have to have your quads, the front of your leg, and your hamstrings working in the back of your leg in order for your joint mechanics to be proper. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We're gonna do 10 repetitions of this exercise also. Good, and pull. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It's time for some short arc quads. You're gonna push yourself back in the chair as far as you can get so your thigh is supported. Very good. You let your heel down the ground. And all you're doing here is you're gonna lift your foot up off the ground until your knee is straight. And then back down nice and easy. Good, and up and down, good. When you're first starting out on this, you're gonna do 10 repetitions, just like you're doing. And eventually you'll actually add weights to your ankle and lift weights with your leg. Good. This gets your thigh muscle moving through a more normal range of motion that's required for when you're walking. It takes a little bit more energy to do this, but it's building a lot more power in your thigh muscle. And we're doing 10 repetitions, up and down, just nice and easy. Very good. It's now time for abduction adduction exercises, and we're gonna do 10 repetitions of this one. You're gonna slide out to the edge of your chair, again with your heel out on the ground with your toes up, and you're gonna slide your leg out to the side and back in until you're straight out from your body, good. And back out and back in, good. And you don't wanna ever cross midline, so you don't cross your legs. That's one of those hip precautions we always worry about, not crossing your legs. So if you just go till your toes are directly in front of you, you're doing it just great. It's also important to keep your toes pointing up towards the ceiling, as that keeps your knee from rotating, which will also rotate your hip, which we don't want to do. It's another hip precaution, not to turn your foot in. Just 10 repetitions of that. And you'll feel that right up in your hip, sometimes up in your groin. You'll feel a discomfort. You're really working those hip muscles. And this one's crucial because when your doctor did your surgery, he had to cut away the tendon of one of your muscles and reattach it. And this exercise works on strengthening that muscle back to normal. Now we're going to perform some gluteal squeezes. So with your leg out, just like it was, you're going to squeeze your bum cheeks together for about 2 seconds and then relax. And as you're doing it, you'll feel yourself kind of rise up out of the chair. So go ahead and do that. Excellent. And that also tightens up that one muscle that the doctor had to go through to do your hip surgery. And this one you can also do all day long. I mean, you can't do too many of these. You can do them when you're sitting around, you can do them in standing, you can do them while you're sitting in the car, driving to work. Nobody will know you're even doing them.